So we're going to talk about 10.7 today. This is complex numbers. So up until now, we've put an answer of a square root of negative 4 as being not real. And that's still an answer if the directions are asking for real answers. So when we talk about domain, we're talking about real numbers. So that still applies there. But we're going to now add a new system of numbers above my real numbers. So we have real numbers here. And below that, we have our decimals, our fractions, our negatives, our positives. But we're going to now add a new group of numbers, which is our complex numbers. And complex numbers are anything that I can write in the form of A plus BI. A is the real part. BI is the imaginary part. What I want you to do when you're writing answers is to always think about writing it in standard form. So this is standard form. You always write the real part first and the imaginary part last. So imaginary means that it's going to include an I. And these are the two definitions that you need to make sure you know and that you're careful to use. I is always equal to the square root of negative 1, and you need to take that out first before you simplify any radical. And if you have an I squared, it's always equal to negative 1. Now, when you look at my math lab, they're going to always put the I in the front, which is okay, but following the rule of A plus BI, you're going to see me usually put the I at the end. I think the reason why they don't put the I at the end a lot of times is because it's easy to think that that's underneath the radical, and it's not. But really, truly, to be in the A plus BI form, you want to put the I at the end. But it will accept it in the front as well. So looking at our first group of homework or examples here, again, the first thing you have to do is take the imaginary part out, and then if you can simplify anything else, you will. So for number one, we have, again, square root of negative 1 times 3, and so then square root of negative 1, the I comes out. They're going to write it in that form. A lot of times you will see me write it in square root of 3 times I and make sure the I is not underneath the radical. Going to number 2, be careful. This negative is outside. That's a negative 1 on the outside, so that stays. So I have, remember, a negative 1 times 9. That is going to give me the I. And then this is going to give me a 3. Truly how you have to do this is you actually have to pull out the I first, but a lot of you will just do it in one step. So my answer here is a negative 3i. The 9 gives me the 3. This negative is from the negative that was already outside, and the I comes from the negative underneath the radical. So looking at number 3, I can pull that negative 1 out. And 8, remember, looking at my perfect squares, would be 4 times 2. So an I is going to come out. A 2 is going to come out, and I'm left with a radical 2. Either one of these right now would be acceptable. I generally a lot of times write it as 2 radical 2 with the I at the end to kind of keep, again, myself reminding myself to put it in standard form. Going to number 4, pull a negative 1 out, and 32, looking at my list of perfect squares, would be 16 times 2. So my answer here would be 4i radical 2 or 4 radical 2i. Looking at number 5, this negative on the outside, be careful. Remember that negative stays. I have a negative 1 times 81. Notice I have everything circled, so everything is going to come outside of the radical. So that negative is this negative from that. I have an I from the negative square, the square root of negative 1, and the 81 gives me a 9. Going to number 6, Again, I can rewrite this, the negative 1, 80, looking at my list of perfect squares, 16 divides into it 5 times. A lot of you might not know that off the top of your head, but that's where you would want to take a calculator and double check. Look at your list and see what the biggest perfect square that divides into it. So a 4i comes out, a 5 is left. You can also write it 4 squared of 5 times I if you're writing it in standard form. Either one of these would work for my math lab. Just make sure the I is not underneath the radical. So now we're going to go to multiplying imaginary numbers. The important part on this is you have to pull out the square root of negative 1 equal to I first. You cannot use our product rule or our quotient rule that we learned in 10.4. You have to first pull the I out before you can combine the radicals, because the rule square root of A times square root of B only works with real numbers. So for number 7, we're going to have the square root of 3 times I, square root of 7 times I. So I can combine the square roots, which is square root of 3 times square root of 7 now, because they're real numbers. And be careful, I get an I squared, because I times I. I squared is defined to be a negative 1. So my answer is a negative square root of 21. You have to pull out the I's first. This gives me square root of 7i, square root of 7i. Combine what's underneath now that they're real numbers. I get an I squared. So the I squared gives me a negative 1. Square root of 49 gives me 7. So my answer there is negative 7. Don't skip steps. Super easy to do stuff wrong in your head. Going to number 9, I can pull out an I out from that piece. And now, again, I can multiply my real numbers together. So I have a square root of 30 times I. There's not an I squared to deal with, so that is my answer. They may write it I squared of 30. Both of those are acceptable, but if they say standard form puts the I at the end. So now we're going to go to division. Remember the same idea of what we did with radicals. When we're dividing by a monomial, it's different than if we're dividing by a binomial, so just know that that's coming. Still, the rule is we can only use the quotient rule if the i's are gone. So the quotient rule, where we took the square root of a over square root of b and could combine it together, works if the imaginary part is taken out first. So very, very important. You have to take that portion out first. So here, I have a negative 1 times 25 times 3. So I'm going to pull out, and that's going to be a negative 1 in the bottom as well. So I can pull out a 5, an I, and I have a square root of 3 left. In the denominator, I can pull out a square root of I, or sorry, square root of negative 1, which gives me I, and I'm left with a square root of 3. Now I can cancel any like terms if they're on the outside, or any like terms on the inside. So these i's will cancel, and these square root of 3's cancel. So my final answer here is 5. You have to pull the imaginary portion out first. So number 11, we have a negative 1, which we really truly have to pull out first. I know I'm showing it as the same step, but you have to know that that has to come out first. And then a 4 times 10. So I have a 2i radical 10 over radical 10. The radical 10s cancel, and I'm left with a 2i. If it's underneath the radical and matches, you can cancel using the quotient rule. If it's on the outside and they match, you can cancel just by canceling the common factor. Now we're going to go to adding and subtracting. This is where what I would call putting it in standard form comes into to play the most. So you want to add like terms. So you want to add the real part and you want to add the imaginary part. Most of you will not do this step, but please be careful. It's 4 plus a negative 3, which is the real part. 6i plus 5i, which is the imaginary part. It's really easy on these to do a sign mistake. So I get a 1 plus 11i, because I added the real part first, plus, and I added the imaginary part. And it's in standard form now. When we have a minus, I've always said, please distribute your sign. Make sure it goes to both pieces. So I have 7 minus 4 plus 3i minus 2i. I get 7 minus 4, which is 3. 3i minus 2i gives me a 1i. So you can write 1i or 3 plus i is okay as well. This one, super easy to not do that minus sign at the second spot, so please make sure you distribute it across. So now we're going to go to multiplication. Multiplication still has distribution, foiling, difference of squares, perfect squares, all of those rules still apply. Be careful. This gives me 24i plus 18i squared. We are expected to simplify that I squared, which gives it me a negative 1 times 18. So I'm going to rewrite my problem in standard form. So I put the negative 18 first, negative 18 plus 24i. Number 15, we need to foil. Draw the arrows if it helps. I get 12 plus 24i minus 8i minus 16i squared. Be careful, super easy to miss that I squared. So I can add like terms. 24 minus 8 is going to give me a 16i. This is going to end up making this a positive 16, because a negative times a negative is a positive. These are now like terms, so my final answer for this problem, I need to take the 12 plus 18, which gives me 28, and I have a 16i at the end. Going to number 16, I should notice this is a difference of squares. Remember, I always do this. It doesn't matter what section I am. I write down my squares first, and then I plug in the two numbers. So 3 squared is 9. 2i squared will be 4i squared. Make sure you do both. This becomes a negative. So 9 plus 4, which gives me 13. This is going to be really important because remember when we dealt with multiplying by the conjugate in 10.5, we got rid of the denominator with a binomial. Same thing's going to apply here when we're dealing with imaginary numbers. We're going to deal with the conjugate for difference of squares to make that imaginary piece disappear in the denominator. So that's our last piece we're going to go to. So now we're dealing with this here. And the important part is we want these in standard form. That's really important to remember. So I want an A plus BI. I want them completely separate. So I'm going to multiply by its conjugate pair of the denominator. So if you think back to what we did in 10.5, I put parentheses around any binomials before I did any multiplication. As long as I multiply the numerator and denominator by the same value, this purple part is equal to 1. 3 plus i over 3 plus I is equal to 1, so I can do that. So the denominator will always fit a difference of squares. So 3 squared gives me 9 minus I squared. That gives me 9 plus 1, which will give me 10 in the denominator. In the numerator, I need to FOIL this out, so I'm going to get 6 plus 2i plus 3i plus I squared. Add my like terms. 6 plus 5i, and the I squared gives me a negative 1. So I get 5 plus 5i over 10. Now, I can simplify this, but I want you to break it up into two separate pieces because you want standard form. So I am going to write it first as 5 over 10 plus 5i over 10, and then simplify. Then you won't make the mistake of not canceling both pieces because that monomial divides into both of the 5s. If you leave it over 10 or over 2, it is wrong because you want this in standard form. It needs to be real plus imaginary. You have to separate it. This is a common spot you're going to lose points on the test if you do not separate it. So please be careful. So looking at number 18, I'm going to start by putting my parentheses around any binomial. I'm going to multiply by its conjugate so that I know it will fit a difference of squares in the denominator. So that's going to give me a 9 minus 4i squared in the denominator, which is going to give me a 9 plus 4, which is 13. In the numerator, I'm going to go ahead and distribute because, again, I'm going to need to separate these. So I got 15 plus 10i. So I'm going to split it up because that's really important. That is the goal in this section, is to separate it into real plus imaginary part. If you leave it over 13 in one piece, it's going to be marked wrong. Going to number 19. Our last problem, again, I'm going to multiply by the conjugate. Even though this is a monomial, I'm going to use the same rule. I'm going to multiply by its conjugate. If you multiply by a negative 2i, it still will work. You're just going to have to deal with more negatives. So in the denominator, this is a square, so it's going to give me a negative 4i squared, which is negative 4 times a negative 1, which is a positive 4. In the top, I get 14i. Now I can simplify that piece. This gives me a 7i over 2 because a 2 goes into both and will cancel. So my answer there is 7 halves i. The advantage of doing the conjugate here is that you'll end up with a positive in the denominator. That just kind of, again, helps simplify your steps. You have to write them in A plus BI form. I suggest every problem doing it that way. Some of the problems, they won't mark you wrong for it. But it's always a good idea to use that format. Difference between earlier sections is if they're asking for a real number answer, you will not deal with the I. This is a complex solution, which will help us for the last two sections, 11.1 and 11.2.